introduce Dr. Simon Western. Simon has just been appointed a visiting professor here in the school as a volunteer, so congratulations, and we're delighted that he has a formal association with us now. But I first came across Simon as a result of hearing about the talk that he had given over in the Sparkle Business School some years ago. I actually wasn't at it, but I then did follow up because the feedback was so positive. And I then attended Simon's analytic network coaching over in Bath. I think it was the year before last, 2014. I think it was the inaugural one.
The first, yeah, you were the first.
Certified analytic network coaching. And I have read with great interest his book on leadership and critical text, another book on coaching and mentoring, which offers a real sort of very nice, from my perspective, theoretical framework for thinking about how coaching and mentoring has developed over the years, and also following on his very interesting blogs as well. So that's how I came to know and still engage with Simon, and we have kept in touch. In terms of his biography and that, I will leave it to Simon himself to give you sort of the key highlights from that. But just welcome and looking forward to the session.
Many thanks, Martin. I'm delighted to be here, and thank you for attending. Today, the seminar, I'm going to go through three things, really. Firstly, I'm going to introduce myself and give a context to where the seminar is coming from, talking about the new zeitgeist, the kind of the times we're living in. And then I'm going to talk about eco-leadership, about really rethinking what leadership is, because to work in healthcare in the next two decades, we're going to really have to rethink how we lead and how we organise. And then I'm going to go on to thinking about how we can reimagine healthcare, really deconstructing the idea of what healthcare is as we imagine it, and trying to kind of begin from the beginning again to rethink it. And finally, we'll have some questions and some dialogues. But I always like to start by doing something I call locating myself. And this comes from experience of 10 years of working with chief executives as a coach, and in many different sectors. I've worked in many different sectors, and what I found is in current times is that many of the leaders I'm coming across feel very dislocated. They're kind of very senior, they're very bright, they're kind of they're very kind of engaged in their work, but you get them on the coaching confessional, they sit there in this kind of space with me, and they confess that they're not feeling quite right. They don't quite know their places. They're not quite as confident as they seem to the external world. And it's not that they're completely lost, but they're just kind of displaced. And my work with these leaders is to really to help them locate themselves. The first thing is to give them some anchor points, to kind of think about kind of their purpose, where they're coming from. And before I give this seminar, I think it's important for me to kind of locate myself for you, so you know where my talk's coming from, so you can see where the social speaks through me. I mean, this is not just me speaking, this is my background speaking through me. So I'm going to give you a very kind of potted history of kind of where I'm coming from, and then you'll kind of understand a bit about kind of where the theories and the ideas I'm talking about have emerged from. So I was born in Bristol in the UK, in England. I left school at the age of 16. I was asked to leave school. I think I probably would have been diagnosed with some sort of ADD or something. I was one of those kids who kind of couldn't sit still in class and couldn't learn in that kind of traditional way. And I was told that I was not very bright, and kind of internalised that a bit. So I went to work in a factory. My first job was in a factory, in a paper bag making factory. And I still hear the ringing sounds of the machines. And women stood at the end of the machines collecting paper bags all day long, moving paper bags from machines to the box. And this kind of tailoristic, industrial kind of way of working was kind of brutal. And in this place, you came to work, you brought your body to work, you didn't bring your mind to work or your soul to work. It wasn't about passion or what you could contribute. You did manual labor. This was about manual labor, and it was on production line scales. So that was my first experience of work, quite a harsh environment. Luckily, I had a friend whose wife was a nurse, and she said to me, Simon, you're good with people, why don't you become a nurse? And it seemed a strange thing to say to a young man at the age of 18. But kind of I thought, well, anything better than the factory, we can give this a go. And I kind of I did a couple of O-levels in the evening class, and I became a general nurse in Bristol at the age of 18. And that experience, kind of the age of 18, of being confronted by the body again in a very visceral way. I mean, I think nursing is, those of you who are nurses here kind of know that nursing kind of puts you in touch with the body in a way that nothing else does. I don't think there's any other profession. You see the living body, the dead body, the broken body, the messy body, you kind of the guts, the blood, the everything is there. Like, you know, you experience kind of the body in a very, very kind of, I can only say visceral way, and the smells and the feel. And you realize the vulnerability of the body, and you realize the kind of resilience of the body, both. And you realize kind of how life and death is very, very close. You know, working in the A&E department in the emergency room, and seeing someone your own age come in from a motorcycle accident, two lads, one of them dies, one of them lives. You know, these are very kind of existential issues you're faced with, they're thrown at you. And nursing in those days didn't do counselling. They didn't do kind of trauma counselling. So you'd see something very, very, very kind of shocking, and you'd be told, Nurse Western, go and get a coffee. And you went on the coffee break, and you took a deep breath. You might shed a few tears in the bathroom on your own, wipe them, come back, and then you start again. And then you probably get drunk at night and sort of lose yourself in a bar with the other nurses and have some camaraderie around kind of around the situation. So that was kind of a very formative learning experience for me. And the other part of that experience was it's a bit quasi-military. You wore uniforms, you had badges of kind of which rank you were. The matron was still there, quite a harsh kind of authority figure. The consultants you didn't kind of question at all. You followed in their line as if you were following the Pope in a kind of line around the wards. And as if you were a student nurse, you kind of just knew your place, and the patients even knew their places even more. So there's this kind of quasi-military kind of sort of authoritarian kind of thing going on alongside this kind of caring work at the same time. So kind of interesting mix. I left general nursing and I went to train as a psychiatric nurse. I got really interested in kind of, when I was in general nursing, the psychology of the dying, caring of the elderly, stroke patients. That was kind of my interest. The kind of the technical stuff around kind of medicines and stuff was not where I was at. I was kind of interested in, kind of in the social and the psychological part of this. So I worked in York, and I was very lucky, I think, because I worked in the old asylums just before they closed. That care of the community thing was going on. They were just closing one asylum after the other. And I worked in one of these huge, big Victorian asylums outside York. And it was a very kind of formidable place. I remember going into a ward where there'd be 70 beds there without any curtains. And people had been living there for 20 and 30 years. You know, and what really hit you about this place was the institutionalisation, and not just of patients, but of staff. What these places did to people, and it was a fantastic learning experience. And I saw raw madness there. You know, people talk about psychosis and neurosis, and schizophrenia. You were there in the middle of it all, and they're giving ECT left, right, and centre, electric convulsive treatment. They're kind of. So there's a kind of harshness to this place, an institutionalization to this place, but also it is an asylum. And it is a place of safety from the world. So there's this very mixed thing going on here as well, that we lived in this beautiful countryside. There was farmland outside. And some of these people, it was their home. So when they did the care of the community thing and they threw these people out into the hostels and the streets, that was a very mean thing to do as well. So from that experience, you learn from the thin boundary between madness and sanity, just how thin that line is, and how easy it is to slip over, and also how socially constructed mental health is. You know, there'd be women in there who'd been in there for 30 years because they had postnatal depression. You know, in the 50s, and they never got out. You know, so how we socially construct mental health kind of it teaches you that as well. I was very lucky there. I met some educated people and they said, Simon, read Goffman, read R.D. Lang, read these antipsychiatrists, and I got really engaged in learning. I really kind of loved the kind of learning, and it made me very question kind of the... It's when I started to become a critical thinker. All my books have this title, Critical Text, on them. coaching and mentoring of critical text, leadership of critical text. And this is where I began to critique society I was living in, critique what mental illness was. So it was a huge learning experience. I left the asylum to go into the opposite end of mental health, and I worked with young people in the therapeutic community, where we banished doctors from the field. We didn't want to medicalize these young people, and we got them to kind of heal themselves in a sense. We set up a community where they could cook for themselves, where they could plan their day, where they had group therapy, and they give each other feedback on their behaviors. So it was all about peer feedback and learning from each other and taking responsibility for themselves. And it was a fascinating piece of work, and I got very interested in psychoanalysis and family therapy. And then for a decade I spent that in Liverpool, training to be a family therapist, working as a family therapist with hugely deprived families in Liverpool in the 1980s, in Thatcher's Britain in the 1980s, you know, the collapse of a whole city, really. And I saw poverty there like I'd never imagined existed in Britain. You know, I came from a council estate in Bristol. I thought I knew what working class life was about, but this was something different. Something very, very kind of harsh and extreme. And I worked with individuals, and then I started working as a family, because you realize that working with an individual is very limiting in a way. You can do so much, but you get stuck. And it started to teach me about systems. One example from that time I recall very strongly was a young man who was referred to me, and he'd had cognitive behavioral therapy, he had kind of aversion therapy. He was labeled as a school phobic, and he was he just wouldn't go to school, and they tried everything with this young man. And he came to us, and we did family therapy, and after building up some trust with the family, we found out that what was really going on for this young man was that he was staying at home to protect his mother from an abusive father. And that's a lesson which has really stayed with me, because it kind of just shows you that not only was this child protecting his family and his mother, he was also getting labelled by the system as mentally ill and getting all these treatments, you know. So on top of his kind of really kind of tough job of looking after mum, he was kind of getting the system kind of doing something to him as well, because people weren't really listening or weren't paying attention, and they were kind of focusing on kind of a reductionist idea of kind of this child's mental health. So it really teaches you kind of don't accept the first diagnosis, don't accept the first system, and think systemically. And I began to think systemically about the challenges. And I began to think beyond families, and I started to work with whole organizations. I became an organizational consultant, because I realized that working with individual children, you had to work with the school system, the health system, the police system, and the social services system. Because if you didn't, they're pulling these families apart. And working with these different systems, you realize that it was like working in kind of foreign languages. The language of the police, the health, the social services were completely different languages. It's like they're all missing each other, and families were caught up in the middle. So I did a lot of work on kind of developing partnerships and collaborative work across institutions. Really, really interesting. I went to the Tavistock Clinic in London, and I studied psychoanalysis of organizations, because I also realized that in these complex organizations, we had rational explanations about what was going on, but it didn't change anything. There was so much kind of going on beneath the surface. People had investments and attachments to certain ways of being, and even though they wanted to change something, they were so attached to a way of being they couldn't change it. So I studied psychoanalysis, and I looked at the unconscious in teams and in organizational behavior. And I did very well there. I got a distinction at the Tavistock, and I went on to Lancaster University to do a PhD. And I did it in leadership. I got very interested in leadership. To be brutally honest, my question was, how is it that leadership is so bad? Because my experience of leadership through all that career had been, I'd met occasional leaders who stood out and were really excellent. Like, you know, you get one or two people who really kind of helped me, but leadership on the whole of these organizations was really kind of not doing the job. And I kind of wondered what that was all about. So I did a PhD in leadership at Lancaster. Very quickly I got taken into to deliver executive education. And I suddenly kind of polarized my work from working with the most vulnerable young people in Liverpool to working with some of the most powerful executives in the world. I was working with a very gifted professor, Jonathan Gosling, and he took me on board, and he worked with me gave me great opportunities, and suddenly I'd be flying to San Francisco and working with Gap global executives in their kind of leadership offices. And I'll be working kind of with Henry Mintzberg in Canada on his health programs, on his international programs. So it's really, really interesting to kind of suddenly work with the most powerful from the most vulnerable. And for me, it was very important to work outside the health sector so I could get some thinking space to see what was going on in the private sector, what was going on elsewhere, and try and understand leadership in a different way. And I didn't want to just understand it from the books. I wanted to understand it in a practical way. And since that time, I've been working as a consultant, as a trainer, as a developer, as a coach, with senior leaders in all sectors. So I work in the health sector, the education sector. I've been working in Canary Wharf and global banks with global OD leaders. I've been working in engineering sectors, in retail sectors, and also in kind of small businesses and hospices. I'm a chief executive as well, to try and gain experience, and kind of that kind of experience kind of goes into the books. When I write about leadership, it's not just from a kind of a theoretical perspective, it's kind of theory come out of our personal experience, personal engagement. So that's my background. Currently I'm running this Analytic Network coaching business, which is about trying to develop coaches who can develop new leadership for new times. Develop eco-leaders, which I'm going to talk about next. I'm also the president-elect of the International Society for the Psychoanalytic Understanding of Organizations. We have an international society where we use psychoanalysis as a way to think about organizations. And this is a big part of my work as well, working with the emotions and working with the unconscious, not just the structures and the material world. So this informs my work a lot. So, and any questions or associations before I move on to the next piece? I just want to kind of locate myself so you could hear where I'm coming from. Are we good to go? Okay. So I want to just briefly talk about the zeitgeist we're working in. The new zeitgeist we're in is what Castells calls, and I use his term, the network society. Manuel Castells writes about this. And the network society is really trying to describe how the digital age and globalization informs social change. We are going through a social revolution, make no mistake about it. And we are just at the beginning of it. You know, the last couple of decades have changed things dramatically. The way things were organized in organizations and in politics, whether you look at global politics, whether you look at the environment, whether you look at kind of technological change, whether you look at schools, whether you look at hospitals, the network society is changing the way we do things. And this is not just about kind of new technology, kind of what it can do for us and how it kind of how it changes some things. It actually changes us. It's not what computers do for us, it's what they do to us. Turkle writes about this. Our relationships change. Our relationships change with our children. When I was a young child, my mum used to boot me out of the house and we used to have great fun all day long and come back for meals. And you'd have complete freedom. Now you're tethered to the phone. You know, there's a very different relationship. You never escape the phone, and there's a panic if the phone goes missing. Now, our intimate relationships change. The way we kind of engage changes. Our whole way of kind of relating changes. And this has major impacts on everything. The financial crash was a domino effect. You know, a bank fell in the United States, and people in Ireland are still suffering today because of it. People in Greece suffering even more. There's a whole connectedness and interdependencies because of globalization and because of the way technology has created new platforms for a hyper-connectedness. There's hyper-connectedness, and what this change really does is it changes the way we organize things, because no longer can we organize vertically. No longer can we kind of elect leaders who can lead top-down. They're still there and they still have some resources and some power, but it's much, much more limited. Change takes place on a lateral plane now. It's all about lateral engagement. So social movements become very powerful. dictators who had the greatest armies in the Middle East looked immovable. Gaddafi in Egypt, and suddenly Facebook, Twitter allowed people to communicate, to engage. They met in the market square, and suddenly these dictators who had total power were brought down, crashing down. The huge banks went crashing down because of the way finance was organized in this new technical way, in this fantasy world of virtual kind of finance. Nobody quite knew what was going on. So things are radically changing, and this has a massive impact, and I want to talk a bit later on about the impact this has on healthcare. This also has an impact on how we lead. When I studied the PhD in Lancaster, my supervisor told me to go away and don't write anything but read leadership for 1 year, which is great advice, because I was panicking about writing this PhD. With my non-university background, I was quite anxious about this, as you could imagine. So I had this free year just reading, and I was working full-time at the same time, but I was working in these new organizations I was experiencing, and I was reading about leadership. And after the year, 18 months, I started to organize my thinking, and this is what came of it, up to here anyway. I organized leadership into three categories, really, three discourses. And by discourse, I mean that the normative way people think about something. So it's just a way we think about something at a certain given time. So if we talk about leadership, we just talk about leaders. And most people kind of talk about leadership as if we know what we're talking about. But we're all talking about something different. And if you're in a different place or a different time, you talk about it in a certain way. So I'm going to give you a very, very brief potted history. If you want to read more, you have to kind of get the book. But a very brief potted history of kind of leadership over the past century to show you where we are today. And I want to then put healthcare into this context. So the first discourse of leadership is a controller leader. And controller leadership comes from the industrial age, where the machine metaphor governed how leaders thought about industry. And at this time, science was the dominant force. Science could save us. Science was like a new religion. So they called this time the efficiency craze, and the focus was on using science and using rationality to produce the most efficient factories. And they did a fantastic job. We have Taylorism, we had Fordist production lines, and they did a fantastic job in making things more efficient and creating mass production. So we got mass production of goods. The prices of cars fell, people could afford cars, the prices of everything fell, people could mass consume. You had mass consumption, And mass production and mass consumption. And this was done through sort of time and motion studies, using science, breaking down jobs into contingent parts. So you try and break things down to make things as efficient as you can. So the old craftsman who used to make a lovely chair would be broken down into 30 tasks. And you'd sandpaper the legs, and you'd cut the legs, and it'd be on a production line system, and things were done in the most scientific and most efficient way. And as I said, this was hugely successful, and it wasn't just successful in the West. Stalin and Lenin used this to modernize Russia. Hitler liked these ideas. It was used everywhere. It was used everywhere as a way of making the world more modern. The flip side of this, the shadow side of the controller leadership against its success, was its inhumanity. People became cogs of the wheels in the organizational machine. So when I described in earlier the factory I worked in, it was pretty inhuman to come to work and spend all day on a machine doing the same task, repetitive task over and over again. Was quite an inhuman thing. So this had a kind of inbuilt inhumanity into it, and this was kind of questioned from the beginning, and it became more and more questioned, particularly after the Second World War. After the Second World War, the idea that science could save us was questioned. People realized that science was a wonderful thing, but it also could be a very destructive thing. You had Hiroshima and Nagasaki, you had the atomic bomb, suddenly science could destroy the world, and science was also used, this factory mechanism, this efficient mechanism was used by the Nazis in the Holocaust. So Karen Armstrong writes very eloquently about this, about how the railway lines, the kind of the factory chimneys, the whole system was worked on this kind of Tayloristic, this killing system was worked on this Tayloristic method. And this was done in one of the most civilized places in the world. Prior to this, people thought that the more rational you were, the more civilized you'd be. But this kind of undid that thinking. Because in this hyper kind of civilized place, one of the oldest universities in the world was next door to kind of one of the biggest death camps. So the idea that science could save us was questioned. In the post-war period, you kind of had a forces for democracy. You had a fear of Nazism and fascism returning. You had a fear of communism sweeping across Europe. So people decided that it was a good idea to treat workers a bit better. And workers demanded better treatment. And there was a kind of a surge towards democracy. And what you got was a discourse I call a therapist leader. And it's a therapist leader because it was born from the human relations movement. And the idea was that a happier worker is a more productive worker. So in the post-war years, you've got this kind of move towards a democracy of workers, and the focus was on how to, rather than how to coerce workers, it was how to kind of motivate workers. So you've got psychology being brought into the business schools. You've got Mayo, you've got Maslow, you had kind of all these experiments, you had how we could organize in groups to get group dynamics working better. And there's a huge kind of piece of work to think about how we could make workers more motivated, more engaged, and get the best out of them to improve production. This didn't disappear. None of these discourses disappear. This is still very strong, and this is very necessary. You need this in organizations. You need kind of efficiency in organizations. It kind of became less. Now, if I draw the arc, it raises again. The controller is back with us through audit control and target control. The computer age has kind of allowed us to be controlled through numbers now. So where it used to be a supervisor overseeing you, now you're overseen by kind of targets and numbers, and you have to kind of, and you're controlled in a more subtle, but just equally as powerful way. So that's kind of making a comeback. The therapist leader is still with us. It's still very strong. You see it in coaching. You see it through emotional intelligence. This language is still very much with us, and it's very, very important. We need leaders and managers who can manage relationships well, manage people well, motivate people. So this is still a very, very important discourse. Why did it go into demise in the 1980s? This followed an economic slump in the US and in the West generally. This great powerhouse, America, which was kind of leading the world economically, suddenly looked over its shoulder and the Asian tiger economies were there. You had Toyota, you had Mitsubishi, you had these companies who were outperforming the great American car companies, the great American manufacturing companies, and they questioned what the hell is going on. This is very, very worrying. We need to do something about this. Our way of managing what our business schools are teaching is not working. We're not delivering. So consultants and anthropologists went over to study what was going on over in Asia, and what they found was that in the Asian companies, there was this collectivism going on. So the traditional American office would be kind of the top suite of floors would be the chief executive's floors with big rooms, big chairs, big desks, and kind of layers of hierarchy. We were kind of the production workers at the bottom. In the Asian factories, everyone would wear the same uniforms. The leaders would eat in the same canteens. You'd have a job for life, you work for one of these companies, they'd give you healthcare, they'd give you education, they'd give you housing, it was a kind of, they'd look after you. You came in, you stood to attention and you sang the company song, as they raised a company flag, you did your kind of exercises together, and then you sat down and you had team meetings, quality circle meetings, and you thought about how you could improve your work. And there's all these micro improvements going on. And this they decided, they saw it was generating better results than this kind of individualistic kind of therapeutic model going on in the US. The question was, how could they repeat it? They couldn't turn America into an Asian economy and a collective society. They couldn't create this kind of collectivism in the same way. But what they came up with was a transformational leadership. And this model was where you'd have a charismatic leader who would offer a vision. So I would come into the company and I'd offer a vision, and the vision would mean that the workforce would have faith in me as a leader, because I'm a charismatic leader, and they'd have faith in the vision. So I didn't have to coerce her anymore. We had a kind of collective, kind of aligned culture. So these Messiah leaders, they're not the great leaders of old. Their key focus is to create strong cultures. And there's a whole kind of piece of work, Peterson Waterman and others who write about cult-like cultures are the best cultures for corporate organizations. So they tried to replicate this kind of cult-like culture where you kind of, you had faith in the leader, faith in the organization, you worked long and hard hours, you didn't need supervision because you were there because you believed in it. You can see, in a way, this controller is about bringing the body to work, the therapist is about psychology and bringing the mind to work, and this is about bringing your soul to work. You know, you work for Steve Jobs because you know he's great and you're changing the world. You work for Google because you're going to just transform the world and you buy in. And you don't need to be told you have to work long hours. You get in at 7 and you kind of leave at 7 p.m., 8 p.m. and you talk work all evening with your colleagues and you go back and there's a crash in the workplace. If you go into Canary Wharf, it's very interesting. It's like a mini state in London. There's barriers to go in there and you have everything you need there. You have your crushes, your swimming pools, your gyms, your shopping. You have this kind of mini state. You don't actually have to go home. I'm sure some people don't. I'm sure some people just live in this space. It's a very kind of strange kind of environment. And they're all focusing on creating strong cultures which drive efficiency, which drive kind of hyper-production and engagement. The trouble is with these cultures is that they become conformist very quickly. So they begin with a kind of entrepreneurial zeal, they begin with an evangelical zeal. We're going to change the world, we're going to create the best company in the world, we're going to do this in a certain way. And they slip into conformity, because anybody who questions the leadership or questions the vision is marginalized and pushed out. They're seen as disloyal. So you get these cleansing operations where you get kind of one type of worker. And I worked in a company in the US like this, and I went in and it was very, very strange, where the chief executive was an incredibly creative, charismatic, dynamic man, and he'd taken the company from a national company to a global company. You know, hugely successful. But then what he'd done is he created everybody in his own image. He employed people and you had to either get it or you didn't get it. You got it, you didn't get it, and you're out. And only those who got it stayed. So we had this company of young designers who were kind of, I went to their kind of cafe bar, and it's like going into kind of a sushi teenage restaurant or something. And everyone seemed to be under 30, everyone was kind of fantastically kind of cool and you can see this is really problematic. This is a totalizing culture where they got rid of anybody with any difference. So these places become conformist. It means that you can't question what's going on. And you get examples of like Enron, where you get very charismatic leaders. Anybody who questions it's forced out, and it ends up in complete chaos and falls apart. So there's a danger inherent in this. So you need some vision, you need some strong cultures, but there's a danger inherent in this way of working. When I finished my PhD, I began to write my first book on leadership, the first edition. And I started to think about what was emerging around the turn of the century. And I came up with this term eco-leadership because the prefix eco was being used a lot more in management, organizational and leadership circles. And it references kind of ecosystems. And people were saying you have to be more systemic, we have to kind of think more globally in this interconnected world, everything's interdependent. Unless we understand these interdependencies inside the company, outside the company, we're going to kind of fall down. So the only way to lead in the network society is through eco-leadership. And eco-leadership is expressed in ways of, in ways such as distributed leadership, it changes kind of from vertical hierarchies, top-down control, to trying to connect people laterally. You try and build connections, you try and distribute leadership, you try and create more ethical leadership, you pay attention to the environment, you pay attention to kind of the downstream workers, people producing your iPhones in China. You have to kind of pay attention to these things these days. Leadership is more informal, it ebbs and flows. So it's not just position power, it's not just leaders at the top of an organization. You can have leaders right at the edge of an organization. You need leaders to work with your customers and your service users, because unless you do, you don't learn what's going on close to the ground. You don't learn changes in fashion or changes in need and demand. You have to find ways to feed this back. It's about collective and network leadership, not just situated within an individual, but leadership goes between people. There's never just a leader. Sometimes I'm leading, sometimes I follow. This movement between us. And it's about leadership being everywhere and leadership that surprises us. So we're really deconstructing the idea of kind of the great leader, your Mahatma Gandhis and these great Martin Luther Kings, leaders who kind of put up there on pedestals, and saying that leadership potential is everywhere and we have to harness the potential to have successful companies. And you can't run a network like a machine. So this movement from thinking about organizations like machines, designing them like machines, where we have input, make something, change something, output, that's not how organizations function anymore. They're like fluid networks, particularly complex organizations like health systems, which I come to later. The shape of leadership looks like this. Controller leadership is your classic pyramid, with the leader, manager, supervisor, worker in a hierarchical structure. Your therapist leadership is very much about small teams, a leader in the middle who looks after their team. They're very relational, very, very good, but they don't have a strategic view. They're good with relationships and people, but they don't have the big picture. The messiah leadership is the man or the woman on wire. So you have kind of one leadership or one small leadership team, and then a very flattened hierarchy with lots of followers who buy into the kind of the leadership vision and have faith in the leader. But equal leadership, as you can see, leadership is everywhere in the organization. And that should be LF. It should be leadership followership, because these things are always interchangeable. The task of eco leaders is to create spaces for leadership to emerge. It's to connect people in organizations so that they create a collective notion of leadership. I'm going to pause for a drink of water. Any questions and any thoughts, any responses?
You said that the controller, that leadership is someone who brings the body to work. The Messiah brings the soul, the therapist brings the mind, but what happens with the leader? What do they bring to work?
They bring it's a good question. I've written something about it in the book. I'm trying to remember what I wrote about it. I've got this kind of graph, so saying what they bring, and I'm trying to think what I put in that box. But they really bring kind of holism. That they bring the idea of interdependence and connectedness. This is what they bring. The fact that the story I told you earlier on about the family therapy of the individual, we're not just individuals acting on our own in society. These are quite individualistic. If you think about it, the controller, the therapist, is about working with individuals and the messiah. They're kind of quite traditional ways of thinking about leadership. This deconstructs that idea. So you're thinking about kind of the interdependencies, you know. The air that we breathe is affected by kind of the way we produce things. The whole kind of the nature of the world is interdependent. So they bring this kind of idea of interdependency and connectedness. And it's beyond just the individual body, mind, or soul.
What do you think will come after?
We'll see. We're not doing very well on this yet. So let's see. But that's a question. people pose to me, and I'd love to know. But I think we're talking about quite a way, because this is just beginning, and we're struggling very much on this one. So let's see how far we get with this. That's what I'm going to talk about next. Yeah. Yes, but it's kind of a yes, but there's a paradox in what the transformation leadership says. It says we grow leadership in everybody, and it wants everyone to kind of, it doesn't want just conformist dummies to come to work. They want thinking people, dynamic people to come to work. So that's right. So it encourages that at one level. That's what it says. But it also says that if I'm a transformational leader, I have the charisma and the power to bring out the best in you, things you didn't even realize you had in yourself. Which is a bit paradoxical, because it's still very dependent on me doing something to you. So there's still this kind of notion of kind of me doing something to you. It is, but it's power. The way it's written and what actually happens in practice is paradoxical, really. The fact that you call them transformation leaders in the first place, the fact that salaries rose from 40 times the average worker to kind of, I think it's about 500 times the average worker over the last 20 years. We're rewarding these people because they're so special. So there's something that's going on there which doesn't go to sync, which I want to distribute everywhere. So it does say that, but there's kind of a paradox in there as well, which kind of works against what it says, is my take on that. Others would argue. There are differences, big differences. The difference often depends on two things. The difference depends on the product, what you're doing. People don't, in the leadership and management literature, there's very little written about this, but actually, if you're producing a car, if you're producing kind of Facebook, or if you're producing healthcare, it changes how you are, and particularly if you've grown up in that system. So what you're doing, I couldn't say like private sectors like this, public sectors like this. It's it depends on kind of whether you're working in retail or whether you're working, like the engineering mindset I worked in Germany would be very different from Gap in America, completely different, you know, and healthcare system as well. So the difference depends on kind of what they're doing. There is a divide between public sector organisations and the private sector, and there's something around dependency cultures, and I'm going to talk about that in health coming up when I get to that. Sure. Yeah. Yeah. I think, I mean, my thoughts on it are that you have to think about things as unique. You have to think about the local and the particular, and healthcare, you know, when I described myself as a nurse and that experience is very, very different to anything people in banks have experienced. And it's very interesting. When I first started to work in the corporate sector, I was very, let's say, very nervous and very kind of, I tried to put on a mask. I tried to kind of hide my background. I was ashamed of being a nurse. I wanted, yes, I'm corporate like you, you know, and I try and pretend to be like them. And then I kind of talk quietly in the bar. I said, I used to be a nurse, mate, and I'm from Bristol. And we'd have the kind of, you know, you'd have a chat. And people were far more interested in that than they were in me being this kind of corporate persona, because they were so bored with that. And this was real. This is something they could touch and feel, you know. And I think, you know, if you're in an engineering company, if you're in a manufacturing company, if you're in a media company, the local in particular is very, very important. But there's also universal things we can learn from each other. So there's, I mean, I learn all the time from small business, big, and saying we're special as a protective barrier against change is not useful. But trying to impose universal neoliberal reforms on the healthcare system, saying it's all the same, is not helpful either. So there's walking a tightrope there. There's a balance between the two, and it's about getting that balance right. No.
You know, so
why is
that happening, and why is it not happening? Why are people not more exercised about
the quality in healthcare? Well, it's interesting. I mean, my experience is in the NHS in the UK, and the NHS sort of dominates every newspaper. Every time you open the newspaper, the news, it's a very dominant part of it. But it doesn't seem to lead to positive change. It's a passive kind of experience of it. Yeah, so. I'll explore some of that. I think this is part of the dependency culture, which we all become part of. We just don't think it can change or something. So I'll talk about that when I talk about reimagining healthcare. Okay, I'll move on to reimagining healthcare. I want you to hold this in mind, because this is what we have to apply to kind of healthcare change. At the moment, healthcare is situated, in my mind, between these two, you know, very much. Targets, audits, you know, and relational leadership. That's where it is. Occasionally they try and fly in someone a bit special to try and bring about changes, but it's not been very well received or accepted. But there's a tiny bit of that, but usually it's kind of, this is where we are, and we fluctuate between these two. That's where we are, and this is where we need to be. Very briefly, the four qualities. It's about connectivity and interdependence. Leadership spirit is important, because in eco-leadership, we're not just talking about systems and processes. Systemic leadership, systemic thinking has been problematic in the management circles, because it's also been a bit dehumanizing. It also talks about communication, feedback loops, and focuses on systems and processes. You have to bring the human spirit into this. You have to have this human spirit central into any kind of systemic or holistic change, has to be there. Organizational belonging, this is about the way organizations have become dislocated and disconnected from local and global communities. Like Facebook and Google and companies not paying their taxes because they don't belong anywhere. They float in the ether somewhere, and they become disembodied, and that's not healthy for them or for society. So we have to reconnect and get belonging back. And systemic ethics refers to really paying attention to climate change, to environmental change, to the pollution. You're dumping your waste somewhere well away from the factory. You're running sweatshops in Bangladesh to produce your nice clothes for Primark. It's about understanding the ethics of the whole system, not just saying we're doing fine on our factory, we treat our own local workers fine. You have to take the systemic position and think about what you're doing to the environment and what you're doing to the wider stakeholders. So on to reimagining healthcare. The problem, as I see it, from my work in healthcare as a clinician, as a clinical manager, and more recently as a consultant to chief executives in the NHS in the UK, is that people are working on a wrong task. We're working on a task which is doomed to fail. We're trying to make the current system more efficient. We restructure it, we borrow an idea from here, we borrow an idea from there. We try and make kind of incremental changes in the contemporary system. And for me, the very system is flawed. The very idea of healthcare is flawed. We all carry around with us kind of an ideology. Slavoj Žižek writes about ideology in the 21st century. Ideology used to be kind of imposed on us from a big other, a Catholic God, an authoritarian kind of regime, communist propaganda. Someone outside us used to impose ideology upon us, and we could kind of fight with it and agree with it or disagree with it, but it's kind of imposed. Žižek says today that ideology is within us. And this is much more dangerous because we can't fight it. We just think it. This is the way things are. This is the normal. And we don't have that critical kind of questioning or kind of fight with kind of the way ideology works. And my thoughts are that healthcare kind of has formed its own sense of ideology. We have kind of an ideology around what we think healthcare is. And I just want you to kind of close your eyes for a minute, take a breath, and just think about what healthcare means to you, just what healthcare means. We all carry with us healthcare in our minds. So just close your eyes a bit, take a couple of minutes and think about kind of what healthcare means to you. Think about the images which come to your mind when you think about healthcare. And when you've done that, just share with a neighbour. Just share those images. What images came to your mind? Just share with a neighbour kind of what you got. Okay, do you want to share some of your images? Just when we think about healthcare, what came up? Just throw out a few words for me. What images did you get? Disconnected hierarchies. A very positive image. Healthcare, what does healthcare throw up for us?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's interesting.
Yeah.
My solution is to have people.
Yeah. Martin?
No, I think you have, I certainly do. You hold the tension, because at one level you think about the interactive, the relational part, but then the reality, I think where he would be is an institution, big building.
Yeah. Yeah, and if you do this with the general public who aren't in the health sector, you get people that they throw out the hospital, the nurse, they throw out the traditional ideas of hospital, nurse, doctors, GP. That's what they kind of that's in there. When I've done this a few times with people, that's what you get from kind of people who are non-healthcare workers. You know, so this tension is there. You know, how people are involved in it, the relational side of it, the kind of. The curative side of it, and then the kind of these buildings, this kind of these systems, these institutions. So what I'm working with, and what I've come to work with is, you know, for many years I tried from the inside and from the outside to try and change healthcare, because, you know, I'm a very passionate person, and when I was working as a family therapist, I was completely invested in my work, and I love those families, I love that work. It's like really, really important for me to. Do for those struggling families. Now, I was working with suicidal young men, I was working with kind of anorexics, so self-harmers. This is very kind of people very, very vulnerable. And I was working in a system which just was not helping me. No, the system was more dysfunctional than kind of the families in some ways. It was a very difficult kind of and very stressful place to be. You know, I kind of faced burnout doing that work, really. 10 years of that and trying to change the system to kind of improve it was a burnout experience. What we've got at the moment is what I call a factory hospital complex. It's a way healthcare is organised around patients as objects. Patients as objects who get broken. So we organise the factory healthcare complex like a factory, like an industry. You have the hospital, you have the GP as a gatekeeper, and the patient comes in, and we think about episodes of care. Financially, you know, how much does a kind of a broken leg cost, how much does a kind of operation cost? We break it down into kind of an economic unit. And the idea is organized around how we supply care. So how do you supply care to a nation? You build hospitals, you have a system, you charge per episode of care, person gets sick, they go to the GP, go to the hospital, get made better or not, and go at the other end either in a box or better. That's kind of the model, it's kind of an industrial model. And it just doesn't work for the changing dynamic. It probably never did really work in that way. It's become more economic and more kind of more problematic with the introduction of market forces, with big pharma, with insurance companies. It's become linked to finance as well, which is even more problematic. My hypothesis is that we need to shift from that way of thinking about healthcare to a mutually networked healthcare, which I'm going to describe for you. It's a shift from dependency from markets and monetism to autonomy, networks and mutualism. It's a whole different way of thinking about health and healthcare. It's a reimagining of it. It's beginning from beginning again. So we have many, many challenges to face. In the next 20 years, we have an aging demographic. We have huge increases in costs around kind of people over 80. Somebody over the age of 80 costs seven times the amount of somebody the age of 30 in terms of healthcare. And we've got a demographic going like this. We're going to have huge numbers over 80. And that's just healthcare. That's not linked to the social care. It's hugely, hugely problematic. We have kind of chronic, complex cases coming more and more increasing. You have diabetes, you have obesity, you have mental health issues, you have depression. You have kind of these complex kind of cases which can't be kind of nailed down in episodes. This isn't a broken leg. You know, when you have kind of these troubles, they mean you have social problems, you have kind of other problems. They're all interconnected and linked. You cannot kind of think about them as a simple kind of episode of healthcare. These are chronic and they're complex, and they need a network solution. Technology is providing ever greater kind of interventions, and it's expensive, increasing costs through technology. There's huge costs in this current system of iatrogenic problems. If you look at the cost of medical failings because of the system, it's absolutely huge. Overprescribing. There's reports in the US. I mean, I've got some figures. It's quite astronomical. Just kind of mistakes in surgery and the basic kind of mistakes. But on a wider scale, because of the way the system works, not on a well-being model, not on a preventative model, not on a public health model. The money is focused on kind of the far end of when you get sick. It's hugely, hugely expensive. And it focusing on supply and not on need, on personalized need, is very, very problematic too. It's a very, very expensive way. We need to kind of reorganize things. You need to get patients out of this dependency culture. What healthcare has done in the last 100 years is move from two main cultures. The first culture is a dependency caring culture. When I was a nurse, I got just the last bit of that culture. It kind of finished or kind of went into demise around 1980. And that culture was, we lived in a society of prohibition. You trusted authority. If you're a patient or if you're a low down nurse like I was, you didn't question authority. You didn't question the matron, you didn't question the doctor. You trusted the expert. They handed out the pills and you said thank you. And within that ethos, mostly, there's a lot of trust, there's a lot of goodwill, there was mostly a caring environment. There was always a shadow side. There was other things going on as well. There was less than caring things going on in that place as well. There was power abuses going on in that place as well. But on the whole, there's a general kind of ethos of caring, but very, very dependent culture, which meant that nurses like myself, who were bright and energetic and wanted to change things, were stopped from changing things. Patients didn't bring their own expertise about their own health to their care. They just stayed silent. Families stayed silent. So this dependency happened around the medical model, around kind of how patients interacted with doctors and with the hospital system. And also within the organization. It was hierarchical, it was dependent, and it was not adapted to change. And it got kind of sluggish and it kind of got stuck. So in the 1980s, and I talk from my experience in the UK, but I think similar things were happening in Ireland around a similar time, you got a modernization agenda. We're going to modernize the kind of NHS. And this modernization happened in two ways. It was about bringing in the market, and it was about bringing in scientific rationality, evidence-based treatments, evidence-based care. So the market reform started to bring in an internal market. We can learn from the private sector, and we can bring this into healthcare. But it's done in a very crude way, and it's created layers and layers of bureaucracy. Modernity produces management. Between 1999 and 2009, the NHS levels of managers rose by 82%. 82% in 10 years. Huge, huge cost and huge rise in management. It was all about control. We had to control this, we had to make it more efficient. It was that controller leadership. we can make this thing more efficient. And they made some gains, but they made huge kind of losses in terms of goodwill, morale, caring. Now, the demoralisation in the health sector, in the NHS, has been huge through this process. So you had the dependency culture, which was failing, and then this market efficiency culture, which at best changes a patient into a consumer, offers them choice. So they say, maybe if you're at the top of the list of insurance, you get some choice, but for the general populace, the choice is very limited. And do you really want to be a consumer choosing products? Is that what being a patient is about? I don't think it is. So there's problems in these two systems. What I'm arguing here is that we have to reimagine this, reimagine health, and start thinking about a mutual network system. That means that you transform the patient into a patient citizen. You have to engage patients in a different way. We have to kind of bring their expertise. We have to treat them personally. In every other aspect of the network society, the personalization agenda is taking hold. In politics, things are surprising us left, right and center. People are not following kind of the general trends. You know, you buy your iPhone, I personalize it. I have my family picture on it, I have my personal apps on it. Everything has been personalized. Our Facebook pages, our kind of engagements. We like to personalize things. The same is happening with healthcare. People need personal care and they desire personal care. They'll be demanding it. So we have to kind of come to that. And actually, it's cheaper. If you act early and you get people getting the care they need around their personal needs rather than kind of like you're this problem or you're that problem, you're not this problem, you're that problem. You've got kind of multiple chronic complex problems which need certain interventions. And to meet those interventions, you need a network of care around the person. And that care is not going to be just a few experts. That care is about the family, it's about the community, it's about voluntary sector can do some great things in this area, and it's about you, it's about how we organise these networks around personal care. And it's about shifting responsibility. At the moment in dependency cultures, you don't share responsibility, you hand over responsibility. We have to kind of re-engage people to be responsible about for their diets, for how they eat. You're not going to attack the obesity problem by just doing gastric belts or operations down the line. You have to kind of hit it at this end. We have to hit it at schools. We have to engage with schools. We have to engage with society. We have to engage public health very differently. We have to co-opt people in local communities to share responsibility, to share ownership, and to share the benefits of healthcare in a very, very different way. And we have to think in networks. It's no good mental health being there, social services being there, health being there. It just doesn't work. The amount of beds clogged up by elderly people who can't go into social care is costing us millions and millions. And it's paralysing the health system. The amount of people going to the emergency departments because they can't get GP appointments is paralysing the system. We have to think in a much more connected, engaged way. We have to undo this idea of the factory hospital in the mind, the hospital, the nurse, the doctor, and we have to take responsibility back. We have to become more autonomous, we have to think in networks, and we have to adopt this kind of mutualist way of thinking. The new technologies help us here because we can actually engage, we can give patients and families new ways to kind of engage with us and with each other to get knowledge. You give an elderly person an iPad and they can press a button and get a direct line to a nurse rather than kind of waiting until they break a leg and go into hospital. It saves an awful lot of money. I was working with BT in the UK around kind of wiring up people's homes to kind of pick up data when someone doesn't get out of bed. You can have earlier interventions. You know, the Internet of Things is going to change things radically. There's many, many things we can do differently, but we have to kind of start from a different place. This is not pie in the sky, this is not something over there. I've been doing this work for quite a long time. I'm going to give you two brief examples. I've been working in a hospice in the UK. I worked with them for 2.5 years. A very dynamic chief executive, and she kind of read my stuff on eco-leadership. She said, I like that stuff. Let's get together, see what we can do. The hospice kind of setup is that they're they're detached from the main sector. They're all self-funded. It's all about charity. It's all kind of funded through local communities. So it's mutualist in its essence. It's owned by the local community. They fund it. Everyone kind of gets engaged in going on fun runs and stuff, and they provide it. What the chief executive was saying was that hospice care is fantastic. Everyone said this hospice is fantastic, but it only had 12 beds. 12 beds for a whole community was problematic. I mean, what about the other 20,000 dying out there? How could we turn the hospice inside out was our question. How could we use eco-leadership to turn the hospice inside out and engage many, many more people? And we thought about this, and they did a lot of thinking, and I went to consult with them once a month and worked with them. And we ended up doing some very, very valuable work. They ended up getting over 100 hospice neighbours in the community to work with people. Because people, when you're dying, don't just need kind of nurses to go in to change bandages. They need the dog walking, they need shopping, they need companionship, they need a lot of other things. You don't need to be a medical expert for this. But when the nurse went round, the nurse was having to spend an awful lot of time being this as well. So you're freeing up nurses' time by getting hospice neighbours. We got community hubs, drop-in centres. We had reach-out centres for the homeless and for immigrants, people who don't access, you know, hospices were mainly for white middle-class people. They're the ones who knew how to access it, knew how to pull the strings to get in. So we were looking at the more marginalised groups. So we were using this, and we were hitting many, many more people, and that work's still ongoing. An exciting piece of work where you're really kind of offering hospice care to the community in a very, very different way. And we were trying to kind of use the resources in the hospital to get out there and offer many, many more people kind of this engaged way of working. And it is all about kind of this mutualism and about these networks. How can we create networks in the community which inform people about dying, inform people about what they could get, inform them about counselling, inform them about some of the care they can get neighbours knock on their doors. And it's about engaging people in a very, very different way. And that was an exciting and important piece of work. It gives you one example. The other example I've got, I was working in the NHS for 2.5 years where we were working with these ideas, with mutual network ideas, in Birmingham. And these were buyers of healthcare, and they won from the government, from the NHS, they won what they call a Vanguard site, where they were offered, they became one of the key sites to offer change in the NHS, to lead change in the NHS. A lot of money was put their way, there's like millions of pounds put in their way, to try and deliver this to the community, where we were working on kind of how we create community hubs for delivering care in a different way. More integrated care, where we bring social work, the GP became a hub, and they're trying to get people to move from going to the A&E department from the hospital to the hub first. And the hub would be a comprehensive blanket of cover. We engage voluntary groups to kind of participate in these hubs, social workers in these hubs, physios in these hubs, GPs in these hubs, nurses in these hubs, mental health workers in these hubs, trying to kind of produce some of this. And it's all in transition, and that was working very well. There's very good examples in Holland as well. I don't know, I've forgotten the name of the movement where nurses have been. Yeah, so you have this example as well, where you really create networks. You allow people to be self-determined and engage in people in their own way, not kind of top-down management. And it's been very, very effective. So these aren't pie-in-the-sky ideas, but we keep on returning to controller leadership. We keep on returning to the old ideas. We kind of know this stuff. This is not revolutionary. We know it. The important piece for this for me, I'm just going to end on this before I have questions. The important piece is our, what I call the libidinal economy of healthcare. It's not so much about the money. There's so much wasted money in the system, it's unbelievable. It's about our emotional economy, what we invest, what we put our investments and our attachments to, the ideology we carry in healthcare. Not just us, but our patients and the kind of whole social kind of idea of healthcare. We have to think about health more than healthcare. We have to think about kind of public health. And there are examples, but another example of this is the most effective healthcare system in the world in relation to affordability is Cuba. And when I was working in Birmingham, I got a specialist in Cuba to come and talk to them, and it's absolutely phenomenal. They're getting the same health results as the US on mortality rates, you know. They're hitting these. And what's really interesting is when you dig deep at how they're doing this, it's about they train a huge number more doctors. And I would say that doctors are more like advanced nurse practitioners. They're kind of a mix between kind of advanced nurse practitioner and a medical doctor. But they're very skilled. They have community hubs on every street corner. They have public health systems on every corner. People are much more engaged in their own healthcare. Everyone's got a family member who's a doctor, so you learn about it. There's no managers in the system. It's all clinically led. It's really interesting. I didn't understand this. It's all clinically led. There's no kind of management structure, except it's all kind of led by clinicians. And their outcomes are just absolutely phenomenal in terms of kind of what they're paying for it. So that's an example, and it's all organized around these networks of care, really, and around this engagement. People are more engaged in their own healthcare. So I'm going to end there, and thank you for listening. It's been quite a long talk. We've covered a lot. Eco-leadership is needed to help deliver this. You can see kind of the links in this network society. We have to kind of think differently. So thank you for listening. I'm going to open up for any questions and a dialogue now. So over to you. Back to communism. Well, there's a downside to communism, and there's quite a dependency culture in communism as well. You know, I'm not advocating communism, but the way they organise healthcare is phenomenal. You know, it is phenomenal, and it's all about local hubs. It's about nodes and hubs and clusters. You start thinking about networks, and it's a very different way of thinking about how you engage people, and that's just one thing they have excelled in. You know. Well, this is the biggest challenge, and you know, until we as professionals, until we as health workers face this challenge, how do we do it? We're not going to do it. At the moment, we're not even asking the question, to be honest. We just keep on trying to rebuild, mend the existing system, improve the existing system, and we're not paying anywhere near enough attention. Even when we pay attention to it, our attention suddenly shifts quickly to control our leadership or do it in this way. Because there's pressing matters we have to deal with today. The strategic move towards this dependency change, and it's not, there's not kind of a top-down solution. It's going to be lots of small bottom-up solutions. And we have to kind of just create space for these bottom-up solutions, and we have to kind of create energy where these solutions can grow from bottom-up.
Doing.
is asking the right questions. We should be asking more questions of how, as opposed to the telling that we're doing. But I'm struck by your last two lines there, and I noticed it in myself that I would be more comfortable if I saw power written there. Because there is something in the health service that I suppose dependency speaks to power. Because there are, I don't think anybody in this room disbelieves what you're saying, and there's something from remote power. But there is an elephant in the room, I think, in the system that is controlled by a very powerful group. And yet we shy away from either acknowledging it or, for that matter, doing anything about it.
Sure, and dependency, I mean, I talk a lot about power in leadership, and one of the problems with systems thinking and ecology thinking is it doesn't address power very often. It kind of addresses communication or biofeedback loops, but power is absolutely essential. But Michel Foucault teaches us that power is not just up there. It's not just something over there. It's here within us. No. So my question is how do we subvert that power? How do we subvert nurses, doctors, health workers are very, very, very often they take pleasure in their displeasure. This is my psychoanalysis. They take pleasure in, you know, they complain and they enjoy their complaining. And they get stuck in that pattern. Power's over there, we need to change them over there, you know. The question you've asked is really important because it's actually about what can we do? How can we do it? How can we kind of empower ourselves to make changes, patient issues, because it's not about top-down power over there. I mean, some of it is. There's structures there which need destabilizing. But you do that not from kind of change the big picture. You do it from like the changing hospice works, and then people learning from that, and then the next hospice changes, the next hospice changes, the next one changes, from changing kind of the place in Birmingham, and then someone else learns from it. People are starting to visit them and learn from it. You know, so this is the way change takes place on this lateral kind of plane now. It's about our biggest problem is this emotional is our emotional dependency on our own power and identification with our professions, which gives us power. That I think that's a big one. I think.
Is there a danger that I could see the autonomy networks and mutualism being an excellent idea, and I was just thinking about just when you said that about the hospice movement changing. Birmingham, and then everybody changes. Then is there a risk that some people just get somehow fall through the grid because nobody's overseen?
Well, there is a there's lots of dangers in all this, huge dangers. But there's what 400,000 people on waiting list at the moment in Ireland. They're falling through the grids. There's an awful lot of people falling through the grids in this system. And as the demographic changes, as kind of the aging demographic changes and the chronic disease changes, there's going to be you're simply not going to be able to do what deliver healthcare in the next 10 or 20 years using the system. You're simply not going to be able to do it. So we have to take some risk, and we have to find out. And the idea is to try and think about ways to prevent people falling through
these gaps. So when you look at that slide of your four qualities of leadership.
Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, that has to be part of it. This is not just some cold system out there. It has to be about the human, individual humanity in the middle of it, and about the ethical position we take to try and make sure that people don't get lost in new systems. But there's always dangers in change, yeah.
And also it depends on, I mean, it's a funny thing about care, that people think it's care and why we care and where we got this from, and how some people don't care so much as others. And so you're depending less on the system and more on the connections, which is, if you can get everyone to agree on an ethics level, yeah, you know, I think it's great. It's just a question of how do we get everybody to do that.
I mean, I at the moment people are very disempowered. People kind of like to, you know, like to blame them over there, like to kind of blame the system. But we do have to kind of shift something here.
Yeah.
And once you become more engaged, you know, Bowman writes about ethics, and he says kind of, ethics depends on the relational, face to face, you know. that's when you kind of realize how to take an ethical stance, because you look someone in the eye and you see their suffering. You know, the more people we engage, the more ethical we're going to be. Yeah. And at the moment, we wait for the doctor or the government or someone else to change it, and we have to kind of shift that. That's why, you know, this sharing responsibility, it's not just saying like we need to treat patients better, it's need to engage them in a very different way. They have to become the patient citizen, individually and collectively.
Yeah.
They have to own their own healthcare, own their own health. I think it has to.
I would think, you know, Oren talked about that, that being a right and a responsibility to self.
Yeah.
But if we go with the assumption that people want that push and responsibility, and, you know, we assume that that's a good thing, but a lot of people don't want the responsibility at all. And if you say they like to say them all, they shouldn't be doing this, you know, for me, or, you know,
Yeah.
But I think it comes from, you know, being healthy and encouraging people to be healthy and all of that kind of thing. It's not as urgent. When somebody needs to get into a hospital, that's urgent. And so that rises the emotion. And so that's then what we fight from. We've just seen that in our recent election of colleagues in aiming that Ireland's the biggest issue. Not providing a society where or human treatment and exercise. We know all those kind of issues well. The big burning issue is, can I get into hospital?
Which is a displacement activity. I mean, we enjoy our crisis. We enjoy it too much now. The newspapers shout about it, and we blame that minister or that minister, and like, you know, we all get pleasure out of this, you know. But it doesn't, you know. We get pleasure out of it until one of our relatives can't get any treatment because there's no hospital left, you know. And what we're doing is there's a systemic ethic going on. We're producing the sort of dependency. It's them over there. We just keep reproducing it. Ministers say they're going to deliver something and they don't deliver it. You know, we keep promising stuff we can't deliver. But there's a lot of people dying out there. You know, there's a lot of people not getting treatment out there, and there's going to be a lot more of them. This is serious. This is really, really serious. And it's like, you know, this kind of displacement activity, yeah, we have to deal with the trolley situation. We don't ignore that, you know. But who's paying attention to this? Who's putting millions of pounds and investment into delivering community care? How can we shift budgets more locally so communities actually hold a budget and make some collective decisions about healthcare in their own areas? That wakes you up to a self-responsibility bit when you're holding a budget. And it's your budget, it's not just them up there.
To pull healthcare almost out of the political thing and for, you know, people to come together and have a plan for healthcare that would bypass elections, you know, that could be longer than a 5-year plan, you know.
You need that kind of energy, you need kind of, and it has to be health and social. And it has to go, you know, healthcare is not doing it anymore, that's too simplistic. You know, it's health and social together, and then it's, sorry. Mm-hmm. Then go on.
I have to say, I really enjoyed your talk, thank you very much. But one of the things I think of the issue, I just love your whole concept and your whole theory, and I think it's great and it should be brilliant, but reality then is, I would just say the word salaries, you know, and trade unions, and all of that, because you can see one of the
eyes of the
changing.
Yeah.
The rise of trade unions is on the downward level, and it's all out of the promotion of private companies, whereas the public system is denigrated because of trade unions and all that. So personally, I would love all of that and implement it, but I think there's a huge issue regarding salary and retaining staff because of salary.
Yeah.
And therefore, it's a permanent staff.
There's huge issues in this new zeitgeist. It's challenging every business, every way of organising, every trade union, the idea of kind of jobs for life and pensions and the stuff is being disrupted by what's happening. And it's, there's huge problems we face with new technologies. The manufacturing sector has kind of lost so many jobs because of technology. And now we're going to lose another massive amount of jobs through kind of new technologies, which can take all the service jobs. Machines can now think for you, talk through machines, that you don't need operators on the end of telephones anymore, That's going to be the next wave gone. There's massive disruptions. The question is kind of, are we going to kind of blindly hold on to what we have and kind of pretend it's not happening, or are we going to try and do something? I'm not disagreeing with the arguments, but we have to kind of do something. No, but I mean, we have to rethink. I mean, one of my future books is going to be rethinking work, because we have to rethink the concept of work.
Yes. Yeah.
We have to really rethink the concept of work.
That's definitely in the.
Now the trade unions in Great Britain kind of like tried to resist, in the mining stuff and Thatcher, and they got smashed. In the end, you can't hang on to something which is not working anymore, and it's very selfish actually, I'm not saying take everyone's wages off them and suddenly pay people Cuban wages, but you have to kind of you have to say it's not just about wages; it's about kind of job descriptions. I'm not doing that; it's not my job description. Well, you have to be more flexible. You carry on with your salary, but you have to be more flexible. And then the next wave of people we train up. I mean, I get dismayed when you think about it. How wonderful it is to when I love being a nurse. I love being a family therapist. Except the system kind of battered me on the head a bit. But when I think about the low morale in these fantastic jobs, it's shocking, really. These are fabulous jobs. To be able to offer healthcare to people, to be able to kind of work in these very, very interesting jobs. You try working in a factory or in kind of like a supermarket, and then you kind of realise what a wonderful job you've got. We have to think about that a bit more, and think about how we can kind of be more flexible about it. And this is not an overnight thing, but we have to move towards this. Now we have to kind of. There's some fantastic kind of innovations going on in the voluntary sector, filling in the gaps of these systems. And they're showing us a way a bit. Social movements are showing us a way a bit. The problems you state are absolutely the problems we have to face, but we have to kind of grow roots and change. Change comes from small. Changes, lots and lots and lots of small changes. Death by a thousand cuts, this is going to be. Let 100 flowers bloom, as my friend Chairman Mao once said.
I saw a programme recently on television about changes in the work practice, where it was set in Norway, and some English people went over there, and they had to, they were working from 9 to 4, and they had an hour for their lunch, which they had to take. And it was to allow sort of a home, a balance between work and other parts of their lives, and productivity, how it was very high.
Yeah, improved because of it. Yeah.
And also health. Yeah. Seems to talk.
Yeah. Sorry.
In the nose of the network, the future healthcare network.
Yeah.
What the role is for private enterprise.
I think there is, but we have to separate that role from. For me, I mean, I'm an entrepreneur. I run my own business. I'm not kind of one of these dependency people. I'm kind of in there trying to create something. And it's tough, it's tough, and you have to be entrepreneurial. That dynamism is very helpful, I think, as part of the big pharma companies who control prices and are just stealing our taxes and selling us drugs we don't need and telling doctors to administer drugs we don't need. No, that's problematic for me. So there's the dynamism of entrepreneurs and people working and allowing that to kind of be part of this. alongside kind of cooperatives, mutualist kind of volunteers, alongside some state provision. It's all going to be in the mix. But we have to disrupt something around this neoliberal agenda, which is kind of like top-down big companies, which are driving a different agenda altogether and literally taking care away from us. So I think in the mix, it's not going to be kind of just a state provision or just kind of a voluntary provision or just a private provision. It's going to be a mix. But we have to challenge kind of this factory hospital complex, which is becoming more dominated by the big players and actually steals money from us. You know, it's our money, it's our taxes, it's our health system we're trying to build here. I obviously don't know it will work. I know that through my experience of working in all these other organisations that this is the companies who are getting on board with this way of working, this new network that we're getting, are the ones who are making huge successes. The ones who are resisting it, politicians, governments, organisations, are the ones who are suffering. So people are kind of, we've got Trump at the moment talking about building walls and fences. It's a great analogy for kind of people saying, like, we don't want to kind of face up to the reality that we live in a network society.
Mm-hmm. I suppose what I'm really asking is, how would you research this, you know?
Well, I think you can do kind of, you can research, you know, you could go and do some research on the hospice I worked in. You could go to research the Dutch example. There are examples of this working. So today, you know, I think you can go and research areas where this has been tried. You could set up a pilot, you know, we could sit down and we could get some funding to do a pilot in one area where we start, you know, we choose an area, we could work in mental health thing, and we start providing a network of care in a different way, and we could do some research on it. So I think you just create pockets of or examples and research them, and hopefully that research spreads the word and becomes successful and grows. You know, I think that's the way forward.
There is quite a large value
model, they're now bringing the budgets of health and social care together, because at the crux of it all is the money, right? The control is being put in place to maximize whatever money there is, but you've also said that that's created a 2% overgrowth of managerial competencies or
yeah.